welcome to everyone to come here to the meeting. And as Jim said, there's a problem with my title. It's evolved, it's changed every few weeks or so. I've looked at this talk and thought, oh, what will I talk about? And this is its most recent manifestation. And what I thought I'd do in this opening talk is to give a kind of overview of where quantum biology came from. And I thought we'd start by looking at the road to do two different disciplines, quantum mechanics and molecular biology. And if we just kind of review where things started, and most of us, I'm sure many of the people in the room are physicists, many biologists, and of course we trace most of our physics back to Newton and the apple falling on the head and all that kind of stuff, through Boltzmann. So Newton, of course, unified terrestrial and celestial mechanics. Boltzmann brought that kind of understanding and that kind of mechanistic understanding to the microscopic world. And everything looked hunky-dory that we thought, or people thought, that the mechanical laws that were discovered at this level could be applied all the way down, until Planck came along and showed, no, there's some problem here. Something different goes on when we start looking at individual atoms, and that, of course, brought the birth of quantum mechanics with Bohr and many other of the pioneers of quantum mechanics who discovered that the structures of atoms and many other features of the microscopic world could be accounted for by this different set of laws. Biology, of course, has a deep history as well, much deeper than we have here. But one of the first points I'd like to take us from is from Descartes. Descartes, who actually preceded Newton by about 50 years or so, but he, as part of the Age of Enlightenment, proposed that living creatures were mechanistic, that they were very similar in principle to the mechanical toys that were around at the time in the 16th, 17th century and were displayed at fairgrounds, clocks and things like this. So Descartes proposed animals. He didn't claim this for man, interestingly enough, for complex reasons I'm sure you're aware of. But for animals and plants, he said there were mechanisms. And the question is, what were those mechanisms? That had to wait for quite a while, really. So a couple of hundred years before Leeuwenhoek discovered the cellular structure of biology, cells. And then Mendel discovered the laws of heredity, and of course that then influenced, and there was a bit of an influence from here to here in that Watson and Crick were influenced by quantum mechanics to explore the structure of genes and what genes were. So these are the separate kind of paths of biology. Now what I wanted to do at this stage was look at what I call the strata of reality, if you like. Trying to bring biological and physical things together here. We, as biologists interested in evolution, we look at the strata of evolution and different layers of the rock. Well, we can kind of think of the strata of reality as being the top layer, all those mechanical things that the 16th and 17th century physicists were interested in, the trajectory of cannonballs, the way planets went around the sun, all of these kind of things which were the mechanical laws. And then, of course, what Boltzmann showed, and many other of the thermodynamic pioneers, was that these mechanical laws could explain things like pressure and temperature and stuff like this if matter was made of all these bits, atoms. And we had statistical mechanics then, which underlied the structure of matter. It underlied the properties of matter, pressure, diffusion, all these kind of things. And then, of course, lower down, we have quantum mechanics and the fundamental laws that govern matter. And we can, of course, take this causal layer in this direction and say that the causal base of our world is quantum mechanics, and then it feeds upwards to all of these kind of different layers. And, of course, the question that we're going to explore in this meeting is, where does life fit in all of this? Which layer is life going to be found in the strata of reality, if we could call it that? And this is a question, this is, if we're meeting your quantum biology, we could trace quantum biology to the speculations, really, and there were speculations back 1944 by, of course, one of the founders of quantum mechanics, Erwin Schrödinger. When he was in Dublin, he gave a series of lectures and then wrote the book, What is Life?, in which he claimed that a living organism seems to be a macroscopic system which in part of its behavior approaches purely mechanical, as contrasted to thermodynamical behavior to which all systems tend as the temperature approaches the absolute zero and molecular disorder is removed. It's a kind of complex sentence, isn't it? We have to kind of disentangle what he means by that by reading the rest of his book, but essentially what he was doing was claiming that life was sitting, at least some aspects of life, particularly aredity, Mendel's peas, etc., were sitting in this layer here, in the bottom strata of reality. Now, why do he claim that? This is his argument, and I think it's an interesting argument, and we'll go through it because I'm going to return to having a look at it later on in the light of modern biology. Schrödinger's argument was that he noted that the exact laws that of mechanics and statistical mechanics that govern the behavior of most macroscopic objects, gas laws, thermodynamic diffusions, are statistical in nature. They only apply to large numbers of particles. And they are exact only because the number of particles in objects is very large. It's huge, trillions of particles. And this gives the phrase which he used in his book, these are really order from disorder. Because at a microscopic level, there is only disorder. Particles move entirely randomly, or more or less entirely randomly, with slight deviations from that. But if all of their dynamics is added up and averaged, then we get the statistical laws, the laws of statistical mechanics. But what Schrödinger pointed out was the errors in these laws are proportional to 1 over square root of n, where n is the number of particles, okay? And as the number of particles is reduced, its behavior becomes more random and unpredictable. So if you have a million particles in an object, then its errors will be square root n, about 1,000, about 0.1% error in the laws governing that object. If you have a trillion, the errors are going to be much, much smaller. But if you only have 1,000, then there's going to be a large degree of error. So in order to get these exact statistical laws, you need big numbers of particles. Okay. And this is what puzzled Schrödinger. Schrödinger knew about heredity. There was a lot of interest in heredity in the beginning of the 19th century. And this is a phrase from his book, genes breed true, that is, they are perfectly inherited. This was known back from Mendel's work, that genes would breed true through the generations. Characters can be passed down with more or less absolute fidelity for hundreds of generations. That was known by the time of Schrödinger. And what this told Schrödinger, that this fidelity implies that heredity is subject to some kind of exact law. There must be some underpinning exact law that allows genes to be perfectly inherited from generation to generation. And he asked the question, what is that law? Could it be order from disorder? The statistical mechanical kind of laws. And he used a very interesting and clever argument. Actually, what he did, and this was before people knew what genes were, at the time in the 1940s, there was a lot of argument, what were genes made of? They knew what genes were, but what they were made of wasn't clear. At the time, the predominant view was they were proteins. And in his book, he does actually describe them as proteins. But he made an argument about how big they were. And from cytogenetic studies, people could look at the genes in the salivary gland of the Drosophila, fruit flies, and could estimate the size of a gene. And he estimated it to be a cube of, I think, 200 angstroms, I can't remember the details exactly, but he estimated that cube could only contain about 1,000 or so atoms. And he also estimated it from mutagenesis data. A lot of studies from De Vries onward had been looking at mutation in organisms, and by looking at how frequently mutations occur with different types of radiation, you could also estimate the size of a gene. And it came out, again, somewhere between 1,000 and 1,000,000 atoms. So The key point was that it was a fairly small number, and far too small to provide regularity in the face of the 1 over square root n rule. So he said this: how can we, from the point of view of statistical physics, reconcile the fact that gene structure seems to involve only a comparatively small number of atoms in the order of 1,000. In fact, we know genes are a bit bigger than that in terms of number of atoms. They're more like nearer to 1,000,000, but still that's too small to provide this kind of regularity. And that value, nevertheless, it displays a most regular and lawful activity with a durability or permanence that borders upon the miraculous. This is a coelacanth, a living coelacanth. This is a fossil coelacanth. 400 million years between them, and their structure is more or less identical. So the genes for the coelacanth have passed down all those millions of years and have remained virtually unchanged as far as we can tell. So that was the problem he faced. And he then looked at the different places in physics where you get order, where you get structure, where you get laws. And mechanics, for instance. Mechanics, the highest level of strata, the Newtonian laws. Well, he basically argued genes are too small to be objects that would behave according to, like a cannonball, essentially. This level here, statistical mechanics, this is what most biologists would have thought, would have gone for, and most biologists still do. They believe most of their phenomena that they study is ruled by statistical mechanics, and by and large, they're probably true for most things, but not all of them, I think. But anyway, order from disorder. He claimed that heredity was too accurate given the size of genes. If genes were the size which he predicted they were, then heredity should not be as accurate as it is. So he ruled out statistical mechanics. In this order, so this represents, actually, I hope it's obvious, these are objects which are made up of distinct numbers of particles in configurations, like crystals, for instance. This is a lower level where particles are moving around randomly, giving us statistical mechanical laws. But if you have small numbers of particles, those laws no longer apply. But once you go down further, you get the quantum mechanical laws that gives you the structure of atoms and these very structured, ordered structures in at the microscopic level. And what Schrödinger was claiming is that life depended on these kind of laws, that it must be order from order. Now, we look at, I won't read the whole sentence again, but the key part is that he claims that life behaves like a system to which all systems depend as the temperature approaches the absolute zero, molecular disorder is removed. Now, of course, mostly physicists here, if we think of this diagram again, when molecular disorder is removed, then you get structure all the way down. So what Schrödinger was claiming is that genes were structured all the way down. They were order based on order. Okay. And genes behaved like highly structured solids, some kind of crystal. But they had to encode lots of information for heredity to work, so he claimed there were aperiodic crystals. Now, question to approach, was he right? Are genes aperiodic crystals? Well, genes turned out, of course, to be made of a single molecule, DNA. And I think that is remarkable. It's one of the most remarkable facts of biology that I think is often not appreciated. We're the only macroscopic objects that I know of whose structure, whose behavior is at one level controlled by a single molecule. I can't think of anything else where a single molecule will control the color of your eyes, the shape of your nose, your intelligence maybe, whether you're going to get cancer or heart disease. That is controlled by a single molecule. I don't think there's anything else that we know of that has that structure, that has that property. So, and we know that DNA is a linear sequence of these non-repeating units, so it is an aperiodic crystal. So he was right in that sense. Genetic information is encoded by the geometry of a single molecule whose structure is determined by quantum laws. So this is a Watson and Crick-based pairing. These are protons, electron pairs on the other side of a DNA base. That structure is determined by quantum mechanics. So at its deepest level, heredity is based on quantum mechanics because this structure is based on strong quantum mechanics. These these distances are quantum mechanically derived. And the stability of those differences is the root of the stability of aridity. But, and it's a big but, by and large, for all practical purposes, aridity can be treated classically. This is how most biologists view genes. We don't really think too much about where the base pairing is. We view genes as a C here, a C base here, will mean that there's a G base there. If there's a T base there, it means there's an A base there. So we view genes rather like classical objects. So classical objects that just kind of meet and marry. So by and large, although Schrodinger was right, and genetic information is encoded down here in the quantum mechanical level, most biologists get on perfectly well with treating genes like they were cannonballs, more or less. That they behave with mechanical laws rather than quantum mechanical laws, simple mechanical laws. So then we take another look at the question we ask, where does life fit in this strata of reality? Well, we have mechanical laws that obviously account for the way that we walk and things like that. At a level of physiology, well, certainly statistical mechanical laws govern the way we breathe and the way our blood flows through our veins, all these kind of things, and various other structures of living organisms. Here's an interesting area here where this statistical mechanics breaks down and we get more randomness, and I'll come back to that. And then at the lowest level, where there are single molecules, we have laws of aridity, the exactness of aridity. Are there other biological phenomena driven by single molecules? This is a key aspect of why it had to have some quantum mechanical flavor to its behavior. It's a single molecule, must have. Well, we know now, and we're going to be hearing about lots of phenomena throughout these couple of days, that we know are driven by single molecules. Enzymes are, or at least many of them, are single molecules. This shows an enzyme in action. It's E. coli dihydrofolate reductase. This is the enzyme structure. These are substrates coming in and out. But when biologists deal with these enzymes, mostly we view them as mechanical objects, classical objects. We don't see any quantum mechanical uncertainty here. We see balls and sticks. And that seems to work pretty well. So single molecules are involved in biology, enzyme action, protein folding, DNA mutation. But by and large, dealing with them classically works pretty well. We don't need to deal with them quantum mechanically. And if I ask what happens next, quantum mechanics, of course, developed further on biology after Watson and Crick went on to molecular biology and the genome sequence, and everything worked pretty well, and we have medicines which are based on this molecular biology approach. It works well and it keeps people alive. So why do we need biology? Does biology need quantum mechanics? So the classical view works pretty well. So when should quantum mechanical explanations of biological phenomena be considered? Okay, remember back to Schrodinger. He actually found a discrepancy essentially between classical expectations and biological data. And are there other discrepancies between classical expectations and biological data? Now, one that Schrodinger picked up on was actually mutation, another aspect of DNA, of course. But he suggested very cautiously that mutations may represent some kind of quantum jump. Watson and Crick picked up on this a little bit in that they suggested that DNA, that mutations may be caused by tautomerization. And tautomerization is a quantum event in that, say, a proton here in the immuno form of thymine moves over to this position here, where in this position it can cause, it can base with the wrong pair in DNA replication and cause a mutation. So this kind of, so it was Schrodinger did propose that quantum mechanical phenomena may be involved in mutation. But well, let's look at that, and we're going to come back to that in a moment. But we know lots about mutation now. Mutation may be caused by all sorts of things, oxidative damage to DNA, ionizing radiation, lots and lots of things. Proton tunneling isn't involved. This guy thought it was. This is Per Olof Lodin, a Swedish chemist, actually. he proposed, he made a very interesting line here, I think, that quantum information is coded by the position of protons along the double helix. In the DNA and RNA molecule, nature has found an excellent mechanism for storing long-time information in the form of a proton-electron pair code. So he was making an argument that the genetic code is essentially a quantum code, a proton position code. And he proposed a mechanism for mutation by proton tunneling. This shows the Watson and Crick, standard Watson and Crick based pairing, but if the proton from here tunnels over to here and this proton tunnels over to there, then you get a non-canonical base pair, and this can now cause a mutation. So he proposed this back in the 1970s, although several theoretical studies have looked at this mechanism, it hasn't really been nailed experimentally. Okay, and what we'll look at now is a few other ideas of quantum mechanics in biology. Hammerhoff and Penrose, of course, proposed that quantum mechanics was involved in consciousness. Again, something not explicable classically, and they claimed that it was explicable quantum mechanically, and I won't go into the details of that because a lot has been said about it. Myself and Jim proposed in 1999 a particular form of a mutation. Now, we're going to come back to this in a moment, but I'll just say a little bit about it. It's called adaptive mutation. It's a kind of mutation might be quantum mechanical. We wrote this paper back in 1999. Stimulated me to write an even more speculative book back in 2000 on quantum biology then. And then what we're going to hear about in the meeting today is that there are various phenomena that may not be explained classically in biology, such as photosynthesis, such as enzyme action, and such as olfactory reception. So there are a number of phenomena that have since been identified that fall under the same kind of umbrella as Schrödinger looked at, as something that isn't easily explained classically and may have quantum mechanical roots. Where else can we look for quantum biology? The problem with biology is it's complex. And most phenomena, although you might say, oh, well, this could be explained by quantum mechanics, biologists will say, well, it may be explained by this or that or that. So many different explanations. So it's difficult to nail a quantum mechanical explanation if there are conventional explanations that work. So you need further clues to look for experimentally tractable quantum phenomena in biology. And this reminds me of the old joke, I'm sure it's been used in many science presentations, where a policeman finds a drunk crawling around on the street, and he asks, what are you doing? And the drunk says, I'm looking for my keys, for my car, I dropped my keys. And he says, well, your car's over there, why are you looking under here? And the drunk says, because I can see, because it's underneath a lamp. And I think that we can use that same approach in biology. We can look for quantum phenomena, not necessarily where they are the most likely, but where we can see them. So where might we be able to see quantum mechanical phenomena in biology? These are some characteristics we would expect. Phenomena driven by small numbers of particles with limited degrees of freedom. These are the kind of things I'm sure everyone would agree with. But how to recognize these phenomena in biology? Okay, oops. Okay, stochasticity is one way we can recognize small numbers of particles. And I'm going to go over that. Briefly, here we are. Where does life operate? We've already looked at this and seen that most of life seems to operate here or here. But there is stochastic biology. We know there are phenomena in biology that are very random, where they don't seem to follow laws. And this has become of great interest in systems biology, where we deal with stochastic phenomena. Now, there is, of course, one stochastic phenomenon, which we've already mentioned, and that's mutation. It's stochastic, it's random, and Schrödinger already proposed that quantum jumps may be involved. In other words, that a disorder may actually be quantum disorder rather than classical disorder. It may come from quantum indeterminacy, a quantum jump that's causing the stochasticity in biology. But there are many other phenomena in biology. Here's a nice, simple one. This is E. coli running around, and you'll see if you watch a single cell, they randomly change direction every now and again. Now, that's a stochastic process in biology. Flipping through again. That is well understood. We know exactly how E. coli moves, but we don't really understand why they randomly change direction every now and again. Now, there are many phenomena in biology that are of this nature, that biological organisms do something a bit random. Stochasticity is something that's a big interest for systems biology. Mutation is one of the things we've looked at. This shows a culture of E. coli cells in which you're looking at gene expression, and these yellow cells are expressing a gene at high level, whereas the other cells are expressing a gene at lower levels. And this is a genetically pure culture, but some cells express genes at high levels, some at very low levels. So that's a very well-established feature of biology, that gene expression is noisy. And what is the source of that noise? This is epigenetics, is another source of stochasticity, and Paul, I think, is going to be talking about that in a minute. This is another, these are individual molecules moving in a cell. And when you look at the motion of individual molecules, obviously they move fairly randomly. Does that have significance in biology? It's not clear. So there are a lot of different biological phenomena. This is one we study in our lab. I'm really a microbiologist. And we look at bacterial persistence. But that's, again, a stochastic phenomenon. When you treat bacteria with antibiotic, 1 in 1,000 of them live. And that seems to be entirely random. Which one will live? Why? We don't really know. So stochasticity in biology, we know quite a lot about it. And we know the processes that cause stochasticity. Mostly it's assumed that the source of biological noise is generally the failure of the 1/n rule. In other words, that there are small numbers of particles involved in any phenomena. For instance, in E. coli, there's only about 10 molecules of the lac repressor in E. coli. So that's going to be subject to whether it's 9, 7, or 11, is going to make a difference to the cell. So that's the kind of noise that we expect. But at least when you see stochasticity in phenomena, you know you're dealing with small numbers of particles. And that's a clue that your system is operating with fewer particles and maybe close to the realm where quantum effects would be expected. So maybe there may be stochastic processes influencing quantum, influencing these stochastic... Could quantum mechanics be a source of stochastic noise in biology? Is a question. Could some of the noise be actually quantum mechanical indeterminacy rather than classical noise? And this is what I want to briefly look at. So could this be, is it just classical noise, disorder from order? Or is it possible that some of this is caused by quantum level noise? How would you know? Well, one way you might know is that quantum noise is subject to complementarity relationship. It depends on what you measure. You measure one thing, the noise will be off in one direction. If you measure another, it will be off in another direction. So quantum noise is different from classical noise, which should be invariant to measurement. So that's an interesting kind of difference that might be possible to detect. Mostly when systems biologists examine stochasticity in biology, look at noise, they assume it's classical noise. But as I mentioned earlier, adaptive mutations, something myself and Jim looked at a decade ago, did give a clue that there may be something to do with measurement in there. So the degree of randomness in many stochastic processes varies, is highly variable. The amount of noise you get in systems like this changes very much dependent on conditions. But that's assumed to be classical. However, there is evidence of conditions affecting the amount of noise. Now, adaptive mutations, I won't go into them in any detail, but essentially it was that these mutations appear to become more frequent than when they provided a growth advantage to the cell. So if you had these mutations allowed a cell to grow when lactose was present, and the frequency of these mutations was higher when lactose was present, apparently, according to John Cairns. So we came up with a possible... That seemed to be kind of like a measurement, that when the mutation was being measured, when it made a difference, then it became more frequent. So we came up with an idea. Oh, well, anyway, this is a little bit more about it. According to classical genetics, mutations are random with respect to the direction of evolution. Mutations are assumed to correspond to classical disorder. For instance, some radiation hits a bit of DNA, damages it. Entirely random process. It shouldn't make any difference what that bit of DNA was doing before and what it does afterwards. That should be a random process. Doesn't make any difference what the function of that piece of DNA is. But adaptive mutations appeared to be more frequent when they provided an advantage. Lactose being present, the mutation that allowed a cell to grow on lactose became more frequent. Was there a hint of a measurement kind of effect? And this is what we looked at. We came up with a very simple scheme. If we have a quantum proton tunneling involved in causing mutations, then you will have an equilibrium between the untunneled and the untunneled form of bases. This won't cause a mutation, this will. When there's no phenotypic difference there, when lactose isn't present, then you'll get this equilibrium between the two states. And we propose that when lactose is present, it essentially drags the system off in this direction because of a growth-stimulated decoherence. Essentially, this, when lactose makes a difference, it causes more rapid measurement of the system and drags it over this way. That was what we proposed. We put a bit more mathematics about it in the paper. But it was hard to prove. And the problem with it, it's adaptive mutations fell the same way of a lot of biological phenomena, in that there were lots of other possible explanations for it that turned up. So we couldn't really convince people that quantum mechanics was involved while there were lots of other things. But recently, just the last slide or two, I thought we'd go back to asking the question whether proton tunneling is really involved in mutation, because if this process is involved in mutation, then that's interesting in itself. If proton tunneling is involved in mutation, how would we find out if proton tunneling is involved in mutation? The idea came to me after going to a meeting that Paul was organizing several years ago, in which people were looking at the effect of enzymatics of putting enzymes in water compared to deuterated water. Heavy isotope effect. Now, if you replace in hydrogen bonds the hydrogen for deuterium nuclei, deuterium nuclei, of course, much heavier, they should tunnel much less frequently. Okay? So we very recently did an experiment in which we grew E. coli in ordinary water and in deuterated water and looked at mutations. This is the little blue colonies are mutations forming on this background of white cells, which are the non-mutant forms. So we measured that rate in ordinary water and deuterated water. Now, this is only a very preliminary experiment, and to be honest, I'm not really sure if I believe it yet, but anyway, here's the effect. This is the mutation rate in normal water, 50% deuterium, 100% deuterium, and the mutation rate seems to be depressed. And that's the kind of thing we'd expect, that the mutation rate should go down if you suppress the proton tunneling. But it's a noisy experiment, a difficult experiment to do, so I'm not entirely sure if we did it exactly right. And also, heavy isotope effects may have many causes in biology. Heavy, when you replace deuterium, hydrogen with deuterium in biological systems, they don't like it. E. coli grows less well, for instance, and it may change lots of things. But at least it was a measurement in the right direction. So that's all I would say about that. But okay, so final slide. Does biology need quantum mechanics? Well, yes, it does, and we'll find out more about it at the meeting. But how much it needs quantum mechanics isn't clear. And this is what I would propose. The places to look for more quantum biology is processes involving small numbers of particles, such as stochastic processes, which we already know about in biology. Non-classical effects, where the measurement makes a difference to stochastic processes, is, I think, an interesting area to look for. And we hope to find more about this at the meeting. Thank you very much.